technical setup. There are many ways to do it. Actually, this is the less common way to do it, but more simple way to do it. To the National Spectrometer. What you need is a laser, and normally that will be an amplified titanium sapphire system with a regenerative amplifier. You generate some 800 nanometer fundamental laser light, and then you split it in two beams, just like in pump probe. And then one beam will go to the pump, and the other, much less, maybe 5%. That's here you can have a darker filter. One part will go for the probe. Okay. Now the pump, you can change the color with the optical parametric amplifier or a non-linear NOPA. So you can get any color you want. And then you have a pulse of the color that you want. That's not enough. Then you need to split this pulse into two. That is done by what is called pulse shaper. Do you know what is a pulse shaper? Well, that's the other way around. You send the pulse, you spread it onto, there are different ways to do pulse shaping. One which is quite easy to understand, the so-called 4F, is again, you spread the pulse into different colors, and then you just mask some of these colors. So you block some frequencies, and then you put it together again, and in the time domain, a Gaussian, if you remove some frequencies from it, it will become something else. So when in the time domain, that pulse will, if you do it right, will become two pulses. Okay. It's very important that basically it's a box that makes from one pulse two pulses. However, with the very well-defined time delay between them, with attosecond resolution and with very well-defined phase relationship between them, because you need to scan the time, you also need to scan the phase. Okay. I didn't say why. Maybe I'll say. So okay, we have two pulses. That's done. Then on the other side we have a probe. Usually we will make a white light continuum just by focusing it onto a sapphire window, and then we have magic happening for wave mixing, super continuum generation, and we have a white light. Very broad. And then we will pass it through a delay stage, conventional motorized stage, where we can delay that pulse with respect to the pump. Just marking pump probe. And then we will maybe have a reference pulse that does not overlap with the pump. That's a trick to reduce the signal to noise ratio, to remove some fluctuations in the pulse generation. And finally, the important part is the probe and the pump are focused onto the same spot on the sample, and again, after that, the pump is not needed anymore. We block it. And the probe is what we are interested in. We measure that. We may also measure the reference. Okay, so basically, if you remove that box, what you see here is nothing else but a pump probe spectrometer. Right? Frequency depends on every experiment. You mean frequency of the pump? It does not matter. You can have, it depends on what system you're interested in.
The
That's why you will. That's why you have the OPA in order to tune the frequency the way you like it, the way your sample likes it. Yeah. But in principle, that is just transient absorption spectrometer. And in practice, with the very, if you have a working transient absorption table, it's not difficult to transform it to a two-dimensional spectrometer, because all you need is to split the pulses to introduce delay between the quantum pulses, and the rest is software. Okay. Incidentally, that part may cost all other parts. But you should know, without the laser, the laser is always the most expensive. Okay. Right, so that was the method. Now we have a few examples at the end. Are you satisfied with the method? Do you have questions?
No.
Okay. So I can continue with some examples on the light harvesting complex, if you remember from way back now. Okay. Yeah. Now, this is again a simulation that shows when we do transient, when we do transient two-dimensional spectroscopy, we can not only follow the couplings between excitons, but we can also follow energy transfer, of course. Now, if we have, let's say, two exciton states or molecules, doesn't matter, and we excite one of them, and then we have some waiting time, and during that waiting time, the energy is transferred to another one, let's call it B. What we will see after if we wait enough so that energy transfer occurs, we will see this cross peak. Even if they are not, even if they do not share a common ground state. Because we excite one, we probe the other. Then there is correlation. Then there is cross peak. So from the position of the cross peak, we can tell where energy came from and where it is at that particular moment. That's it. Very simple concept. So we measure in time. And as energy transfer proceeds, we can follow the generation of this cross peak, basically the transient population of that state will increase in time. Maybe then it will follow to another path and then it will decrease again. So basically we are measuring the kinetics of the system. Just by following the intensity of the cross peak in time, we get the rate equation. That's the goal at the end. The goal is to get the rate equation of the system, the kinetic equation. Okay? So that's the thing. One, this diagonal peak, that's the initial state. It will disappear. Instead of it, the cross peak will appear because energy moved from the excitation position to the detection position. That's the principle. Now, here is one thing that made two-dimensional spectroscopy popular in the first place. So popular that it created a basically boom that is called quantum biology. I think now we are at the end of this boom. When we have exciton states and we excite these exciton states with the coherent laser, we create another type of coherence. It's the same in principle, coherence, but not coherence between ground and excited state. We create coherence between exciton states, because with a broadband narrow time pulse, we excite many states at the same time, and then if they are coupled, there will be coherence between these states, between these excited states. Right? So that's one was called coherence between the ground and the excited state. That's the principle how we measure. The other, the more tricky part is We have two excited states and we have created coherence between them. So the energy can go from one state or another. This is coherent energy transfer. Very interesting phenomenon. Many people work on it. Two-dimensional spectroscopy gave a very clear experimental evidence that for coherent energy transfer. Because if you have coherence between exciton or excited states, then the cross peaks of these excited states, they will pulse, fluctuate. They will show these oscillations. So we have this two-dimensional spectrum, and if we follow in time, the cross peak will, one cross peak will disappear, the other will appear in phase, or out of phase, but coherently. So if you plot one is enough, take one cross peak, intensity, plot it in time, that's not coherence time, that's population waiting time. And then you have oscillation. So-called quantum beats. Again, the oscillation, of course, the frequency of the oscillation is the difference between the two exciton states energies. So then it was thought for theoretically that such kind of coherence does not exist in biology because biological organisms work at room temperature, and temperature is powerful decoherence engine. It just randomizes everything immediately. So phase relationships cannot be retained for a significant amount of time. However, people made experiments with 2D spectra on different lighthouse antenna complexes, and they saw a relatively long-lived this kind of oscillation. You see, long-lived coherences. And then the question is, oh, if these coherences can live such a long time, they can, it means during the time these relevant processes for photosynthesis or whatever vision take place, then maybe this quantum behavior is important for the process itself. Maybe because that's more theoretical, but in principle, this coherent energy transfer is a could be much more efficient way, because when you have coherence, you simultaneously probe all the pathways. You don't choose randomly one or another, but you have simultaneously all the pathways, and so in principle the system could be more efficient. And now, I cannot go further than that. This is, as I say, another chapter in its own right about this coherent phenomena in biology, not only in photosynthesis. It's very still not very well settled topic, so it's under intense research. But what I'm saying is that the two-dimensional spectroscopy gave the momentum of all this area of research. Anyhow, so let's go back to the Lighthouse complex, just a few examples. So, yeah, maybe we skip those examples. Alright, so I think the whole idea of the method I covered. So
maybe a small suggestion. I can also speed up my talk a little bit. Okay, which may allow for you to
okay. Thanks. So
I don't have much to say.
Examples are always very interesting because they also show how the method works. So
right.
If you
thank you so
a few more minutes, I think it's well worth.
Thank you so much. Well, here's the LHC, you remember? That's one example. This is the ground state absorption spectrum. And it's composed of different lines that we don't resolve in the spectrum, but basically we see two peaks, that's powerful A and that's powerful B, the green ones and the blue ones. Now we can have an experiment where our laser covers all the chlorophyll B states, the pump, and the probe covers all the states. And here is the example. This is the two-dimensional spectrum and how it evolves in time. Here is a chlorophyll B peak that on the down. And here is a chlorophyll A peak, cross peak. One disappears, the other appears. Then we can take a line here, 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 we can follow that. This is basically like if we did pump probe with different colors. Okay. And then we can take the dynamics of these positions. This is from there we can get the kinetics of the system in rough words. What we do is we take global analysis, we calculate exponential lifetimes from all these traces. And then we get what is called decay associated spectra. That's not really so specifically now important. But from this spectra, we can get correlations again, one frequency with another frequency. So we can tell from where energy comes, where it goes. That's one example. Another example, we can cover the chlorophyll A area only. Here is one more interesting thing. Here we have cross peaks above the diagonal and cross peaks below the diagonal. If we look at one place or another place, we can see energy from one place moves towards low energy or from another place towards high energy. So what we see is at the same time, energy transfer from low energy states to high energy states, and from high energy states to low energy states. You cannot see that in one dimension, because they cancel each other. But in two dimensions, you can see these cross peaks. This goes from high to low, this goes from low to high. This is thermal